Christmas comes, chili's on the breeze, and the family's all in town. The lights are on the tree, and it won't be too long now. Feels like joy.
Examples of what needed to happen in order to prepare for Christmas. What were some of those things that you heard? I didn't hear that. Road work. No, I'm actually thinking about during the greeting time. Your favorite parts of getting ready for Christmas. Being with family. Being with your siblings? Very good. What else did you hear? Waiting for Santa. Waiting for Santa. Santa's got to show up.
Yes.
What if he doesn't? We're in trouble, right? All right? Any other preparations for Christmas? This shouldn't be that hard. Decorations. I heard decorations. You're going to have to speak louder because I can't hear very well. But
putting the lights up.
Part of the decorations, yeah. What else we got? Putting up the tree. That's important. Yeah, making the presents. Putting the presents together if you need to put some presents together. Watching Christmas movies. That's obviously part of preparation for Christmas time, right? But someone said something down here. What'd you say? Eating. Well, eating's obviously a part of this. Any other preparations for Christmas?
Children.
Children?
She said children.
Okay. Okay, very good. I was thinking, you're going to have a child? Yeah, that is part of the Christmas story, but it probably isn't the preparation for everybody. But yeah, seeing the kids, seeing them gleefully open all their presents and all of that, that's definitely part of Christmas, right?
When did Christmas start before you opened any presents?
Reading the Christmas story. That would be a great part of preparation.
Office parties.
What was that?
Office parties.
You got to have those, I suppose. Wrapping the gifts. I heard snow over here somewhere. Okay, now we're getting warmed up a little bit. Any other things that you could think of?
I think we better not forget that we're celebrating
Jesus. Jesus would be a good part of that, right? Going to Christmas pageants is on my list. Enjoying the snow, reading the story. Shopping is obviously part of it. Not the funnest part, for sure. I went to Costco on like last Tuesday or Monday, and it was nuts already. Alan? Gary's coming to help pick up leaves. That should be part of all of our Christmas preparations. Yeah. Going to the parade with the elf and Christmas with Beth. Right? All right. Well, is there an order to these things? We have lots of things that we have to get done, but is there an order? I mean, can you eat the treats before you make them? No. I mean, can you put the tree up after you open the presents? That's probably not going to work, right? So there is a certain order to some of these things, right? In fact, the Bible also has a certain order to the Bible, to this Christmas story. In fact, it has kind of a pre-story. It's kind of, you know how they do that with movies nowadays? They have this pre-story, trying to tell the story before the story. And that kind of is what happens with the Christmas story, if you think about it. There's a story that happens to prepare people for the story. It's kind of interesting, right? In fact, the prophecy that Janet just read was written hundreds of years before Jesus came. And it's this prophecy that someone was going to come and would speak as kind of a forerunner to the actual Messiah that would come. A person who comes into the story to prepare the people for the Lord. That's what it said, right? Our story for today is my opportunity to be a part of Big City. Now I get to read the story to you so that you know what the topic is about. And it starts in Luke chapter 1, verse 5. And it says, in the time of Herod, king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah who belonged to the priestly division of Abijah. His wife Elizabeth was also a descendant of Aaron. Both of them were righteous in the sight of God, observing all the Lord's commands and decrees blamelessly. But they were childless because Elizabeth was not able to conceive, and they were both very old. So what do we know so far? Well, back then, lineage, whose family you're a part of, was way more important than how much money you had as far as your standing in society, right? And this couple, Zechariah and Elizabeth, they were both descendants of Aaron, which means that they were pretty important because they were part of the priestly line. Both of them were, right? That's what it says. They were blessed. And not only that, they were righteous in someone's eyes. You know who they were righteous in the eyes of? God. It says they were righteous in the eyes of God. Now, that's way more important than being righteous in the eyes of someone else, right? Righteous in the eyes of God would be an important thing, right? And oddly enough, they don't have any kids. And back then, not having kids, not being able to have kids, was considered a curse of God. It was something that wasn't looked on very well, right? Kind of an odd part of the story, right? And yet they were old, very old, it says. So there's probably not much hope to actually get that removed, right? And one of the great honors of priests at that time was to serve in the temple. And we saw some mention of that in the story. And the greater honor of that is to actually burn some incense in the temple on behalf of the people. And that's what happens in Zechariah's life in our story. It's kind of a once-in-a-lifetime thing for priests to be able to go into the temple and light the incense on behalf of the people. And so in verse 8, once when Zechariah's division was on duty and he was serving as priest before God, He was chosen by lot, according to the custom of the priesthood, to go into the temple of the Lord and burn incense. And when the time for the burning of incense came, all the assembled worshipers, they're outside praying. I mean, you kind of see the scene. All the people are outside worshiping as Zach is going into the temple by himself, right? And he's going to burn that candle of incense. At least he thought he was going to be alone as he burnt that candle of incense. Verse 11, it says, "Then an angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing at the right side of the altar of incense. When Zechariah saw him, he was startled and he was gripped with fear." Is that a surprise? Can you imagine being in a room that you thought you were alone, a very sacred room? I mean, I've heard lots of stories about people scared going to go even in the church, right, at nighttime. What's going to happen to me? Which is kind of funny, but it's true, right? Sometimes you're in these places and you're a super sacred place, and yet all of a sudden there's someone there, an angel of the Lord. So of course you'd be terrified. Verse 13 says, "But the angel said to Zechariah, 'Do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard.'" His prayer has been heard. What prayer has been heard? Obviously, Zechariah and Elizabeth had been praying that they would have a son. But now they're old. They would have been praying for that anytime recently, right? Can you imagine your grandma or your grandpa having a baby when they're old? I mean, that would be tough. But another prayer that the Israelites would have been praying for was for what? The coming of the Messiah. They'd been praying for the coming of the Messiah for 400 years. The Messiah had never come. Waiting and waiting and waiting. And so which one of these do you think the angel was going to answer that day? How about both? Second part of verse 13, "Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you are to call him John." Do you guys know what John means, the name John? It means that Yahweh has been gracious. Yahweh has been gracious. "He will be a joy and a delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He's never to take wine or other fermented drink. Instead, he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even before he was born. He will bring back many of the people of Israel to the Lord their God, and he will go on before the Lord in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the parents to their children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." So who's this angel talking about? The forerunner, right? John the Baptist. The one who would come and prepare the way for the Lord, the coming of the Messiah. He'd be born to who? Zechariah and Elizabeth? Is that right? This was really a miracle on two counts. First, they were never able to have kids. And two, they were very old. How can this be? And yet we see this happen multiple times in the Old Testament history, right? Very important people that were born to parents who could never have kids. Only by the grace of God, only by a miracle would that happen. Do you believe that God could do such a crazy thing? Do you think that even would be possible? And you know Zechariah had the same question, right? Verse 18, Zechariah asked the angel, "How can I be sure of this? I'm an old man, and my wife is well along in years." You notice he didn't say that she was old. That was pretty wise, right? The angel said to him, "I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God, and I've been sent to speak to you and to tell you this good news. And now you will be silent and not able to speak until the day this happens, because you did not believe my words, which will come true at their appointed time." Zechariah had a hard time believing, didn't he? So in order for Zechariah to know that it was true, what did Gabriel do for him? It was actually a gift, a sign. He wasn't going to let him speak. He wasn't able to speak until the baby was born. Verse 21, it says, "Meanwhile, the people were waiting outside for Zechariah, wondering why he stayed so long in the temple. When he came out, he could not speak to them. And they realized that he had seen a vision in the temple, for he kept making signs to them, but remained unable to speak. When his time of service was completed, he returned home. And after his wife Elizabeth became pregnant, and for 5 months remained in seclusion. And listen to what Elizabeth said. "The Lord has done this for me," she said. "In these days he has shown his favor and taken away my disgrace among the people." I mean, did she believe that it was true? Yeah, she expected it, right? That she was going to have a baby. Even when she was well along in years. Not old. Well along in years. It says, when it was time for Elizabeth to have her baby, she gave birth to a son. Her neighbors and her relatives heard that the Lord had shown her great mercy, and they shared her joy. On the eighth day, they came to circumcise the child, and they were going to name him after his father, Zechariah. But his mother spoke up and said, "No, he's to be called John." And they said to her, "There is no one among your relatives who has that name." Then they made signs to his father to find out what he would like to name the child. And he asked for a writing table, and to everyone's astonishment, he wrote, "His name is John." And immediately his mouth was opened and his tongue set free, and he began to speak, praising God. All the neighbors were filled with awe, and throughout the hill country of Judea, people were talking about all these things. Everyone who heard this wondered about it, asking, "What then is this child going to be?" For the Lord's hand was with him. And then Zechariah's song, his father Zechariah, was filled with the Holy Spirit, and he prophesied, "Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, because he has come to his people and redeemed them. He has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David. As he said through his holy prophets of long ago, salvation from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to show mercy to our ancestors and to remember his holy covenant, the oath he swore to our father Abraham, to rescue us from the hand of our enemies, enable us to serve him without fear and holiness and righteousness before him all our days. And you, my child, will be called a prophet of the Most High, for you will go on before the Lord to prepare the way for him, to give his people the knowledge of salvation through the forgiveness of their sins because of the tender mercy of our God, by which the rising sun will come to us from heaven to shine on those living in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the path of peace." And the child grew and became strong in spirit, and he lived in the wilderness until he appeared publicly to Israel. I mean, isn't this a cool story? God doing something miraculous. God reaching out to save his people. But the most interesting part to this is that he used regular people to do it. People that even didn't believe at first, right? With Zechariah. Isn't that so awesome? I mean, can you believe that God uses people in his story? I'm so glad I read this in the Bible, don't you think? I mean, do you believe that God could even use you?
I think that was an incredible story. Zechariah couldn't believe, he couldn't speak because he couldn't believe what the Lord told him through what the angel of the Lord told him. And that must have been a big deal for John the Baptist. I mean, to prepare people for Jesus. And let me tell you, if God were to ever speak to me, I mean, I would believe him. No questions asked. Mm-mm. No. That was a great story, wasn't it? It was incredible, wasn't it? I mean, we would all believe the Lord, wouldn't we, if he were to speak to us?
Heywood, where are you?
Oh, no.
Heywood, there you are.
What is it, Heather? What happened?
Dirty little speed bump in the highway of life. I just found out that I've been chosen to be on the cover of Spoiled Star magazine. Why didn't you tell me?
Oh, I can tell why you're upset about that, but I didn't know about it. Oh, Spoiled Star magazine?
Horrible. It's horrible. I'm double booked with my surgeon tomorrow. I'll never be ready in time.
Oh, I thought you were upset because the magazine called you spoiled.
If you would have... As I was saying, I need my surgeon to remove this unsightly wrinkle on my hand, and I'll never be ready in time.
Well, who do you think I am, John the Baptist? I mean, it's not my job to get you ready. Get yourself ready.
You certainly aren't any John the Methodist. You couldn't get somebody ready if your life depended on it.
Baptist. It's John the Baptist. And I'm Haywood the Christian. And I can prepare people to learn about Jesus, and that's more important than some silly, silly magazine story.
It is time for our memory verse. The kids up front know what this is all about, but I'm gonna need participation from everyone in the room, all of our big, big city kids today too. So I'm gonna need everybody to stand up with me so we can stretch our legs a little bit and we can work on this memory verse. It is an easy one, so don't worry. But the verse is to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. What was John the Baptist's job? To make ready a people prepared for the Lord. So when we are prepared for the Lord, our hearts are prepared for him. So we're going to do some motions. You ready? First, we're going to start with two. So you guys lead the way here so they know what to do. To make ready. All I could think of for ready was like a race. So ready. Everybody's got to do it with me. Ready a people prepared. We're preparing our hearts for the Lord. Okay? You ready to do this? And it's Luke 1:17. Okay. Now, you're going to have to say it so that I can hear it. Okay? So, big city kids, you got to be loud, but big city kids, you got to be even louder. All right? Here we go. Let's say it together and do the motions with me. Here we go. To make ready a people prepared for the Lord. Luke 1:17. All right. We're going to do it one more time, and then I'm going to ask for some volunteers to say it for us. All right. So let's do it one more time. Here we go. To make ready a people prepared for the Lord. Luke 1:17. All right, so you guys can take a seat if you'd like, but I'm also going to be looking for big city volunteers. So it's not just the kids in front. If anyone wants to say the verse, we're going to hear from a few people. We have one ready right here. Cameron, start us off, please.
To make ready. People prepared for the Lord. Luke 1:17.
All right. So good. If the motions throw you off, you don't have to do the motions. But I forgot to tell you that we are going to have you turn around so you can't read the screen. So anyone else want to volunteer without looking at the screen? We're going to try it out. All right, Isabel.
Oh my God.
We're start with two.
To make ready a people prepare for the Lord.
Very good.
Luke 1:17.
Awesome. All right. Okay, so I'll take one from the boys' side, and then I'm going to look for somebody else in the big crowd here.
To make ready of people. Prepared for the Lord. Luke 1:17.
Awesome. Okay. And can I get one more volunteer from out in the rest of the crowd here? I have some kids here.
Really? Come on, folks. Somebody. I might have to pick on somebody if I can't get somebody. All right. Thank you, Wendy.
All right. To make ready a people prepared for the Lord. Luke 1:17.
Thank you so much. All right. Thank you, guys.
Welcome to Z Street Live. I'm your host, Tyler, and we're going to have some fun today. High five. High five, high five, high five, high five, high five. All right, high five. So, show the girls how it's done. Show the girls how it's done. All right. All righty. Did you guys have a good Thanksgiving?
Yes, I'll just turn it down.
Good. How many of you guys put whipped cream on your pumpkin pie? Yeah. You guys like whipped cream? I love whipped cream. All right. Yes, well, we got a fun game in store for us today using whipped cream. So I'm going to need 4 volunteers. We're going to need 2 boys and 2 girls. Let's go. You, and you. Oh, sorry, Chase. I need a girl. Why are you on the girl side? Come on up, Wei Wei. All right. So, who wants to go first on the girl side? Rock, paper, scissors. Who wants to go first on the boy side? Logan. You might want to take your coat off. It's a fight for the girls to who's going first. All right. So what we're going to do, this is called whip whistle. We have a whistle on the plates. We're going to cover them with a lot of whipped cream. These guys are going to have to fight using nothing but their face to grab the whistle through the whipped cream. The first person to blow the whistle wins. We're going to need a lot of cheering. Girls root for girls, boys root for boys. We'll see who wins. Ooh, that looks like how I have my pumpkin pie right there. Nice and covered. All righty. We're going to go ahead and count down from 3 to 1 as a group. And then, hey, got to stand up. You got to sit up. Yep. Keep your hands behind your backs. Hurry up. We're waiting. All right. Everybody is a group. 3, 2, 1. Go! Oh, who's going to get it? Who's going to get the blow? Who's going to get it? Who's going to get it? Oh, Cameron! Cameron gets the first win. The girls are up 1-0. No pressure, Steele. No pressure. That's how Lisa looks after eating her pie. All right, Steele, you got to show us how it's done. You got to make the boys proud here. I don't want to see the girls get 2 wins on us here. Hold on. Are you going to take that home and eat that later? No. Yum. Get every little bit of that out of there. Perfect. All right. Hands behind your backs. Wei-Wei, stand up straight. All right. We're going to count down again as a group. 3, 2, 1, go! Don't swallow it. Steele wins, so it's a tie. Good job, guys. Good job. Awesome. All right, well, we'll be back next week. Thank you for joining us live on Z Street Live.
All right, it's time for my favorite part of Big City, make a scene. So how many of you guys paid attention to the Bible story? Paid attention to the Bible story? Okay, good. I need some actors and actresses. So, you guys are looking at each other like, you know I'm coming for you or something. I wasn't until you did that. And now I need both of you. Abby and Taylor, come on up. You guys, give them a big round of applause here. All right. Okay, so let's see. I need, so we got, I need, who were some of the characters that were in the story? Who was in the story? We'll call him Zach. Zachariah? Okay, Zachariah. Okay, you want to come up? I'll have you be one of my people. All right, let's see. Who else was in one of the characters? You guys know who the characters were? There was an angel? You're going to be... Come on up here, man. Come on up here. You got it. All right, and I need, everyone's like, don't look at me. Yeah. Kenny, I got to have you up here. Kenny, come on up here. I believe in you. You're an amazing actor. All right. So let's get this going. I need, Shelby, can you be one of my producers? No? Okay. We need, okay. Chase, you can be my producer. Okay, here you go. So I need you. Can you do that? Okay, perfect. All right, so I need... You're going to be our Zachariah. Are you good with that? All right, so Zachariah, where was he at the beginning of the scene? Where was he? He's going to the temple. All right, so Zachariah is going to be up here. Okay, so you're here. So you come up here, and then let's see. Who's going to be my angel? Oh, you're totally going to be my angel. All right, so you're up here. Okay, and then I need you guys. Can you guys be my special effects team? Okay, so you guys are over here. I'll have you over here. I need you to pick out three people from the crowd to be a part of, like, the crowd of people that are talking. So go grab them. Go grab them. All right. And then I need... How did Zachariah put it? His wife was a little bit old. His very wise, mature wife. Do I have anyone that's willing to be a wise, mature person? Yeah, Sarah's pointing at people, but let's see. Anybody? Nora, will you? No, Nora's like, please don't pick me. Please don't do it. Okay, I won't do it. All right, I'm going to bug Ruth. Ruth, can you come up here? Yeah, all right. So, okay, you're going to be in there kind of lighting some incense, and then you're going to come in, and we'll do this, all right? So hit the little clapper board for me, and I need you guys, I'll have you guys over here, okay? All right, let's roll film. And so I just need you to be praying and lighting some incense, and then I need you to come and, like, scare the daylights out of them. All right, here we go. And action! Cut. Oh, man. Hold on. All right. I need more energy, but I don't blame you. Special effects team, I need you in here. I need you to make them shiny like an angel. Thank you. Okay. Yes.
Only if you don't ask questions.
Perfect. I'm loving it. I'm loving it. Okay. Love it. Oh, Halo. Perfect. Voila! Yeah! I like it. Okay. All right. So this time, let's try it again, see if you can scare him. All right. Do it again. All right. And action! Cut, cut, cut! We need more special effects. Okay, hold on. Okay. Hold it, hold it. Hold it with that hand. There you go. Perfect. Beautiful. Okay. We just aren't getting quite the effect that I need. Here, special effects team, you use this. Okay. And you got to have these glasses on because of insurance reasons. Okay. Here we go. All right. Ready? Let's see it. Watch your eyes, people. Ah! Beautiful. Okay. Get a good shine on them. There we go. All right. Now, let's see it. So, action! Perfect. All right. I love it. Now tell him that he's going to have a son.
You're going to have a son. Oh, my. I'm such an old man, and my wife is very mature.
Brilliant. All right. So, all right. Tell him that he's going to have a son named John.
You're going to have a son named John.
And then you don't believe it. So now you can't talk. So act like you're trying to talk, but you can't talk. Nothing's coming out. Oh, man. All right. Okay, so Angel, you go away. Awesome. Beautiful. Carry him. He might need it. All right. So then I need the crowd of people to come here. And so you're kind of like trying to figure out why he was in there for so long. All right. And so, okay. And then you can't figure it out. He can't get anything across. So you guys, I need you all to cheat out this way towards the audience. And I need you guys to just act like, this guy's crazy. Yeah, perfect. Love it. Okay, now I need you to go home to your wife. So wife, I need you to come here. Okay. And by the magic of television, you are now pregnant. Here you go. You can just like hold that over top. We'll CGI it just perfectly. All right. Love it! Okay, so I want you to be really surprised about this, okay? But you can't say anything, all right? Action! Perfect. Man, like, great job. All right, and now lose the baby there, and by the magic of television, bam! Beautiful. Okay, and you want to name him, so tell the group of people what you're going to name him. And you guys are like, that's not his name. He should be Zach. Okay, so you guys go and ask Dad. But Dad, you need to tell them what his name is. Okay, can you do that? Okay, so you guys are like, what's going on? Okay, I need you to hold it up real high. Bam! And now you can talk.
Wow.
Perfection! Put your hands together! Let's give him a big round of applause. Thank you! Cut! That's a wrap! Awesome! Great job, everybody! Great job! Oh, my word. Thank you so much. Man, the production value around here is incredible, right? Yeah, just does not compare. Okay, so that brings us to our knot of the week, which... That's not the knot. So the knot of the week for us is Zach did not believe the angel. So we're going to do Zach did not. And when we say not, woohoo, we got a big knot here. not believe the angel. So Zach did not believe the angel. So I need you to stand up and boldly say it. Can you do it for me?
Zach did not believe the angel.
All right. Okay, who can do it for me? All right.
Zach did not believe the angel.
Perfect, perfect, perfect. Okay. All right, here we go.
Zach did not.
Zach.
Zach did not believe the angel.
Man. Remind me to, you know, like he's got that Morgan Freeman voice going on there. Like next time I have a God in my scene, I'm going to bring him in. All right, hold on. There has to be some people here. Yeah, do it. Oh, my bad.
I have a microphone here.
Okay, so. Perfect. Thank you. All right. Let's do it.
Zach did not believe the angels.
Yeah. All right. All right. Hold on. Let's see. You guys have already done cool things today. Yeah.
Zach did not believe the angels.
Yeah, awesome. Great job.
All right, I got time for one more. One more. Third, I'm coming for you, man.
Zach did not believe the angel.
Yeah, thank you so much. All right. Okay, one more time for Clayton. Here you go.
Zach did not believe me.
No. Oh.
That kid is hilarious. All right.
All right. So you're up, man. I'm out. Oh, yeah. There you go.
All right. Yeah, I'm not the angel. All right. Let's see if anyone remembers the memory verse. Make I'm not gonna throw that. Come back to you. Emerson, you got it? What do you got?
To make ready a people for the Lord, Luke 1:17.
Nice. Very good. There's one word we were missing. Prepared. And what was this? I want to see from some of these adult kids out there, what was the sign for prepared? Yeah, it was heart, right? You're preparing the heart, okay? So making a people prepared for the Lord involves our heart, okay? And what was the not? I'm going to ask some older kids here, just a second. What was the not? All right, Zechariah did not believe, but there was actually two people in the story, right? Who's the other one? Who's the other person beyond Zechariah? I can't hear you. Elizabeth, right? Was the same true of her? She did not believe the angel? She did, right? Now, we've been talking about preparing, right? We're preparing for Christmas. We're preparing for this story. We're preparing for what is to come. And obviously it seems like preparing includes our hearts, includes believing, right? Believing is kind of an important part of the story. Because Zechariah needed to believe if he was going to be used by God, right? Is that true of us as well? If we're going to be used by God in his story, do we need to also believe that he's doing what he said he would do? Yeah, we've got to be able to trust. And maybe that's the part we're supposed to pick up for this morning. How do we prepare for Christmas? It starts with believing the story, right? Starts with believing that God wants to use us and that we can trust him to use us. Drew, would you pray with me this morning? Lord God, I do just thank you for the opportunity that we have to do this as a family and to really just share life together with kids and adults and just have a fun time this morning. But what an important story as we prepare for Christmas. We need to trust you. We need to believe you. You want us to be a part of your story. You want to use us in incredible ways, but we have to believe that you can do what you can do. It's not believing that I can do it. It's believing that you can do it. Lord God, as we enter into this time, this season, would you help us to remember to believe? Would you help us to choose to believe that you can use us in incredible ways like you used Zechariah and Elizabeth in this story? And we will give you all the praise. Amen.
All right, we got one more thing to do, and that is our real-time review. So, let's see. Gary Bacon's not making eye contact with me, so Gary, come on down. We need you, man. Woo! All right, yeah, Logan, come up. Beth, come on. Can you do it? Come on, Beth. Yeah. All right. And then I'll have Shelby. So I got 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Counting is so hard. I need... everyone's like trying not to make eye contact. It's great. I'm going to go with Chase. You can go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Perfect. And let's see. Ivy, come on down. Come on down. All right. Okay, I need you guys up here. So I need 5 of you over here, actually. Woohoo! Perfect. And then, I'm going to have Beth, you come over here. Gary, I need you over here. So, Beth, you're over here. And so, Beth, what I need you to do is I need you to roll these to the kids over here, and they're going to grab these, so you just kind of bowl them over to them, and then we're going to put it in order. Yes, you got this. I believe in you. Okay, so roll those over to them, and they're each going to grab it, and then we're going to try to get it in order and figure it out. Okay. Nice. All right, next one. Next one, believing. Okay. Whoa! All right. Nice. Great job. All right, so I need you guys to get in a line right here, real quick. All of them with the words facing out. All right. Facing out, words facing out, make a straight line. Here we go, and I'm going to have you guys read what's on your thing. So here, no, just do it. Here we go. So here
is
important.
Hold on, just read it.
Real.
God. Believing, real, God. So we have is important, believing, real, God.
That's not right.
Okay, so I'll probably put Shelby down there. God is, let's put, yeah, believing God is real important. Okay, nice and loud. Believing
God
is
real.
What? Real?
Important.
All right, here we go.
Let's do it one more time. Everyone together. Here we go.
God believing
God
is real important, isn't it? Woo! All right, so I need you guys to come over here again. You're going to roll them back to Beth. She's going to collect them. There you go. All right, here you go.
Let's do it.
All right. I didn't think this one through. My guitar's right over there. Awesome. Don't worry, we have insurance for these reasons. Yeah. Great job, Gary. All right. And you can head on down to your seat, and we'll roll that. Oh. All right, you got this. You got this, Shelby. Let's see it. Oh, awesome. All right, give them a big round of applause. All right. Church, would you stand as we close this service together? All right. Thank you, thank you. All right. Church, we have such an amazing God that He allows us to be a part of His story. He allows us to come into His story and be a part of it, and for us to get to choose to love Him, to have a relationship with Him. And what an amazing thing it is. And man, I know in my life, I want to remember that believing God is real important, because He is so good. Would you just pray with me? Jesus, we just love You. We thank You. We praise You. May You go with these, with Your children, and just allow Your love to just shine through. Let us be so overwhelmed by the blessing it is to be chosen by You, loved by You. God, may we choose You back. We love You, and we ask all these things in Jesus' name, and all God's people say, amen. Amen. And you are sent.
Hello, Mr. Gutter. I mean, Mr. Nice Gutter Bowl.